Welcome back to K-Talk. It's not very often that we have Democratic candidates here on this station. This is a very conservative talk radio station, probably the most conservative in the entire state. District attorney race. The winner will be chosen Tuesday. Sim Gill, Democrats running against Lohra Miller, Republican. And there are more things that matter in the district attorney race, in my opinion, than partisan politics. The district attorney really has nothing to do with abortion or Iraq or any of these other issues. And so I am supporting Sim Gill, Democrat, with us in studio. Pleasure to have him here. And you were here once before. Many of our listeners probably heard you here before. Many of our listeners probably haven't. So take a couple minutes. Tell us who you are, why you're running.
Well, first of all, thank you, Stephen, for having me here. It's a pleasure to be here and to be with you.
Get a little closer to the microphone there. There you go.
It's a pleasure to be here and to be able to talk and discuss these ideas here, because I think you and many of your audience there, you know, I believe in good government, and I think it's about having a healthy and open dialogue and discussion, and so I really appreciate the opportunity. As you mentioned, my name is Sim Gill. I'm running for Salt Lake County District Attorney. I've been a public prosecutor for over 12 years. I prosecuted for Layton City, Salt Lake County, before being appointed as the Chief City Prosecutor in Salt Lake City in the year 2000, where I've been in a management and administrative capacity for the last 6 years, managing the largest municipal prosecutor's office in the state of Utah. Prior to that, I was 5 years with the district attorney's office, where I prosecuted felony prosecutions with the arson fraud unit, did a whole series of things from everything from robbery cases, ag assaults, to white-collar crime, sexual exploitation for profit cases, distribution of pornography cases, and so full gambit of felony prosecution. And so, you know, when I think about this office, and the reason I'm running is that, you know, I have the experience of a line prosecutor when I was at the district attorney's office. I have the experience of an administrator managing, an active caseload of some 30,000 cases annually. And then, of course, I have the experience of a policy analyst. You know, I'm currently the chairman of the Salt Lake Area Safe at Home Coalition, which is focusing on issues of domestic violence, how we can get assistance to victims of domestic violence. And we're doing some really innovative and interesting stuff there. We're going to be starting what's called a family justice center. Instead of having a victim go all over town looking for services, we thought, wouldn't it be interesting if we brought all the services together in one location? Because that would empower that victim and get those services wrapped around quicker and faster and make them a zone of safety quicker. I'm the vice chair of the Criminal Justice Advisory Committee with Peter Caroon as the chair. I've been on that executive board, and we focused on the systemic challenges to the criminal justice system countywide, everything from jail overcrowding issues to alternatives to incarceration to technology upgrades. So I bring those three components, but most importantly, what this is really about is about public safety. The district attorney's office has 88 attorneys, 66 of them are on the criminal side, and it is about serious crime in our community, which impacts our sense of safety, our sense of community, and in deep and profound ways.
Now, your opponent is Lohra Miller, Republican. She has the support of the attorney general. She has been a city prosecutor, never prosecuted any felonies. A lot of people worry that she lacks the experience necessary to manage a group of prosecutors as large as the one you just described. And you guys started out in a very friendly race with everyone being courteous. And over the last few weeks or maybe month or two, things have gotten a lot uglier. At least it looks that way to me. She's made accusations about you, and she claims you've made accusations about her, but I don't know that you really have necessarily. What is going on?
Well, you know, I think unfortunately politics is an interesting process. I've never run for office before, so this is my first time at it. Early on, I made a commitment. I said, look, we're going to keep this clean. I went to Ms. Miller and I said, we're going to keep it clean. We're going to focus on the issues, and I don't want to make this personal. But at the same time, I think of late, recently, there's certainly been certain statements that have been made, and there's certain, representations which are not accurate. So I don't want to say that this is, I don't want to make it sound like it's negative, but I think it's important to clarify the issues and you know, just to share that information as openly as we can.
Okay, here's some of the things that she's claimed about you. She's claimed that you've repeatedly plea bargained DUIs to reckless driving.
Well,
that you're soft on DUIs. How do you respond?
Well, that's an amazing statement, because Lohra and I couldn't have a more different view when it comes to DUI prosecutions. I mean, first of all, For her to even suggest that we'll go from a we plea bargain a DUI straight down to a reckless is misses the most fundamental notion that there's actually three stages. You can either plead somebody to a DUI or an alcohol-related reckless and then straight reckless. We don't plea bargain DUIs down to reckless. We might plead them down to an alcohol-related reckless if it's warranted. You're sentenced the same way, you're convicted the same way, you're enhanced the same way, so there's no compromise in that sense. There is an actual conviction. Now, one of the most fundamental differences between myself and Ms. Miller is that she actually gives plea in advances to DUI offenders. Now, and let me just explain what that means. That means that she offers you a plea bargain at the end of the conclusion of which your DUI is dismissed. It's an outright dismissal. So let me just sort of, again, let that sink in. We're talking about, under her model, the DUI is dismissed. End of story.
So she's claiming that you're soft on DUIs when the DUIs that she's plea bargaining are being totally dismissed. And it's you're not actually plea bargaining your DUIs down to reckless driving. You're plea bargaining them down to alcohol related.
Yeah, some of them, yeah, we convict them. Look, she and I have a difference of opinion here, which I can respect, which is that that I don't believe that drunk driving cases are things that we should plea bargain on. The risk from drunk driving in our community is so great. The potential for destruction of property, the potential for destruction of life is so great that we need to make a policy decision to say that whoever drinks and drives will be aggressively prosecuted towards conviction. And in fact, I'm the only one between the two of us who's actually prosecuted felony DUIs. The irony in this, being labeled, I mean, if you want to know, the irony here is that I actually had a case where Miller and Miller, when I think it was the seventh or eighth DUI, they gave a plea in advance to this person, and I got the next DUI, which was, I believe, the ninth DUI, and I actually ended up prosecuting that DUI towards a felony conviction. So
somebody had eight DUIs, got a plea in advance, and then on the ninth,
I prosecuted
a felony on your third.
Yes.
We'll be right back. Dr. Sim Gill, Democratic candidate, district attorney. Hope you're all voting Tuesday.
AM 630 KTKK.
Dex, I need to find a place that rents pneumatic jackhammers and can deliver one today. Sweet Fanny Francis, Dex, what happened to you?
What was that? Today? A jackhammer? Okay, let's see. We got six in town, and Heidi's House of Hammers says that when it comes to delivery, they've nailed it.
Dex, are you feeling okay?
A little blue and yellow.
It's just that you're looking a bit worn around the edges, frayed, perhaps even tattered. Gosh, we're gonna need some tape. I need tape!
What about Conn's Home Hardware? They're the Condu Hardware Store, and they're just two blocks away. Their number is...
Oh, Dex, we have used you to the point of... You're so brave, Dex, so very brave.
Dex, the most complete directory in town is also the most used directory in town. As a matter of fact, people turn to Dex more than any other directory. It's got all the local info you need when you need it.
Hey, honey, what's going on?
Look at Dex, honey. Look at him.
Man alive. Who did this to you, Dex?
Look, you did.
Can you speak?
I'm fine, really.
Dex, the one that gets used. Dex knows.
Gah, call them dogs in, put the fire out for the best authentic hickory smoked barbecue this side of the Mississippi. Ranked in the top 10 barbecue restaurants in the United States by MSN.com and CitySearch.com. Sunset Magazine has us as best in the West. We got ribs, chicken, beef, pulled pork, hot links, sausages, southern fried chicken that'll make you kick the bucket to the curb. And lordy, lord, lord, fried catfish. Real homemade side dishes like sweet yams, collard greens, coleslaw, mac and cheese, black-eyed peas, seasoned rice, and lard cubed beans. Do yourself a favor. Come on out to QPU Hickory Smoke Barbecue Restaurant, located at 4655 South, 4800 West, where the ribs and sauce are boss. Call for takeout at 955-8858. Delivery service is available. Open Monday through Saturday from 11:30 till 9 p.m. Check us out on the web, y'all. www.qpu.com.
Welcome back. Elections are Tuesday. We've got Sim Gill, Democratic candidate for district attorney, with us in studio. Pleasure to have him here. One of the perks of my job is I get to meet interesting people, politicians, authors. I'm sorry about the commercial break, Sim. These things pop up and interrupt us.
No problem.
What is the difference between what you've been doing the last 6 years in your capacity as a prosecutor and what you were doing before that with district attorney?
Well, as I mentioned, currently I manage the largest municipal prosecutor's office in the state, and which is a management and administrative responsibility. But I've also been cross-designated with the district attorney's office during this period as well. So even though I've been managing and making sure that the budget is being followed, that we are expanding appropriately, the resources are being used, I'm dealing with personnel issues, I'm dealing with elected officials, appointed officials, and, the entire whole thing of running a very large, the largest office in the state of municipal prosecutors. The other thing is that during that period, I've also been cross-designated, and I've helped start a lot of different interesting programs like mental health court, misdemeanor drug court, different kinds of programs, as well as making sure that, felonies, there are certain felonies that have been of interest to me on my cross designation that I've been prosecuting. So I've been prosecuting felonies. I did a whole series of distribution of pornography cases, which were felony cases, while I was the chief city prosecutor. I've done a bunch of felony drunk driving cases, some environmental crimes cases. And so, it's been a more of an administrative job. But prior to that, I was for 5 years with the district attorney's office with the arson fraud unit. As I mentioned, I prosecuted everything from robberies to aggravated assaults, different kinds of serious crimes that we see in our community.
And you prosecuted 1,800 felonies, you guess, during that time?
Well, let me just give you an average. I would say probably in the 5 years that I was there, anywhere from, I would say, 1,200 to 1,800 felonies minimum. Yeah.
And Lohra Miller, in her 15 years as prosecutor, has prosecuted no felonies.
That's my understanding. And the challenge there is, look, we bring different skill sets to the table here. But the challenge here is you're talking about a district attorney's office, which is primarily responsible for felony prosecution. There is nobody else who does that. And you're going to come into an office where you have to have some knowledge, experience of those felony prosecutions, because your people who are subordinate below you are the ones who you have to educate about and talk to about, and they're going to respect you if you have an understanding of it. When you come into that office and everybody else has more felony experience than you do, how are you going to lead that office? That's a very fundamental question.
Lohra Miller has been claiming that you haven't prosecuted enough felonies only because in your administrative capacity these last few years you haven't done a lot of jury trials.
I've been working as an administrator and running an office, and the district attorney.
Which is the same thing you'll be doing if you're a district attorney.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I mean, you've got over 200 employees there. You've got a $20 million budget. You're working with the elected official, appointed officials. You're working on the civil side, on the criminal side. You've got managing over 200 people. It is a full-time administrative job of running that office, policy management, resource management. And it's a full-time administrative job. It's not somebody who's going to be out there going into the courtroom. But you have to know what you're doing. You have to have the understanding of those serious felony prosecution. And I'm the only candidate who has that.
Yeah, I can't imagine anybody disagreeing that the district attorney ought to have a pretty good understanding of felony prosecutions. There's been, you've been a gentleman. Lohra had some campaign finance problems that were talked about in the Tribune and the Deseret News. And you didn't try to use this as an issue or really exploit that problem for your own gain. But then she's come after you for these other things. What happened with this campaign finance? She was trying to get employees, or forcing city employees to get...
Well,
still not clear.
No. Well, look, it's in the paper. And the bottom line is, this is something that is serious. This is something that was looked into, and unfortunately, it's a very poorly written law, so they couldn't find any issues in terms of a criminal sense. But I think there's a question that is there that needs to be answered, which is, is this a, is this, was this appropriate?
And if it's not illegal, it's unethical.
Well,
it would seem.
I guess you can say that, and I've tried to just sort of stay clear of that. This is focusing on our positive thing here. I think her actions speak louder than my words can. So we will let, I think, the citizens decide on what is good and ethical, responsible government. So
you talked about this a little bit. General policy differences between yourself and Lohra. What are the big ones?
Well, I think the most important one is experience. The most important one is knowing what this the responsibility of this office is. The other thing is that I think we have to talk about commitment to good government. You know, I think it's important to make sure that we run this office in an ethical and responsible way, not just only when we're there in power, but how we get there in the process of getting there. I've devoted my entire life to public process, and I believe in good government. And that's a commitment that I've made to Mayor Caroon. That's a commitment that I will make to every citizen. That's a commitment that I will make to every elected and appointed person who's part of within my domain of practice. The district attorney's office will not be political. It will not have a personal agenda. It is going to be a commitment to good government. And I believe in making sure that we go back to basics, which is that we do our job professionally, that we make sure that I'm a big supporter of mental health court. I'm a big supporter of therapeutic justice programs, which is smart prosecution, where we transition people out because I'm a fiscal conservative. I think that when the citizens give me their tax dollars, I better make sure that I get the biggest bang for that buck. That means that I lock away the people that need to be locked away because I take my job very seriously, but we do it in a smart and efficient and effective and a fiscally sound way. So those are the conversations that I've had with the mayor. Those are the conversations I've had with the sheriffs. Those are the ones that I've had with the county councils. And those are the ideas that I want to bring to the district attorney's office.
And that's what I want to hear as a voter in that district as well. You've got four retired judges endorsing you. A lot of law enforcement.
Yes. Look, my support is I'm very proud of our campaign thus far. I have one of the largest police unions, which is the Salt Lake City Police Department, supporting my candidacy. But beyond law enforcement, I have well in excess over 100 attorneys who understand, who are supporting my campaign. And the most incredible, and very appreciative of, I have four retired judges, one of which is a retired Supreme Court justice, and three Third District Court judges, because they're the ones who have been in the courtroom. They understand what the serious nature of this office is, what it means to our community, and what it takes in a leadership as well as practical experience to run the most serious office, a law enforcement office in the county here.
Let me ask you a question you may not be expecting. Yoakum has been the district attorney for the last however many years. We had Nancy working on this program once. Her political career was ruined by the prosecution in the district attorney's office. And we've had some listeners who've called in, and whether it's an appropriate way for them to be feeling or not, I don't know, but they believe that Rocky Anderson committed some different types of misappropriations. But because the district attorney was a Democrat, he didn't go after Rocky Anderson like he did Nancy Workman. Do you think that politics have played a role in the district attorney's office in the past?
Let me answer it this way. The district attorney's office cannot, should not, and certainly will not be political under me. I make that absolute commitment. Now, there are, and the press and everybody else may want to politicize. My job as the public prosecutor is to depoliticize that. Now, I know that there are going to be elected officials, appointed officials who are going to make mistakes. And one of the first things that I'm going to do, because the integrity and the responsibility of the district attorney's office is so important to our sense of community, that one of the first things that I'm going to do is I'm going to create a bipartisan advisory panel with Republicans and Democrats, who I hope I never have to use, but we will have, well in advance, should these kind of issues come up, that they will help decide whether a criminal wrongdoing has occurred. Because it is still the responsibility of the district attorney's office to do their job, but we must do it in a way that cannot be perceived in a partisan way, and it cannot be perceived in a way that makes it look like that there's no integrity within the office.
Well, that sounds like a good answer, and I'm convinced that you mean it. We are talking to Sim Gill, Democrat. We'll be right back.
AM 630 KTKK.
Imagine a place where you are totally free. Free to be who you want. To think what you want. Free to worship. To love. To express yourself. To speak out against the things that make you mad. Imagine living in a place like that. Oh, that's right. You do. America, it's a free country, and for over 200 years, it's been our job to make sure it stays that way. We're the men and women of the United States Navy.
Man, my I want the internet at a cheaper price without cable TV. She said no dice, you gotta get a bundle of all these other things. I want the SL without all the strings. She said you'll have to sign a 2-year contract. I said, ma'am, you're giving me a heart attack. I want DSL without that other stuff. I want to simplify my life. Is that so tough? I don't want a bundle, don't want a contract. Is that any way for a lady to act? She said, I know what you need, man, I've been so dumb. You want to get your internet from mybigworld.com.
No contracts, no bundles. Internet service without the hassle. Sign up today online at mybigworld.com.
Welcome back. This is KTalk AM 630. Talking to Sim Gill, running for district attorney. Most of you, our listeners, will be voting in this district on Tuesday. At least I hope you're going to be voting Tuesday. So, Sim, tell us about some of the different programs you've implemented as a city prosecutor.
Oh, well, I'm really excited. The one that I'm very, very proud of is the mental health court. Mental health court, you know, about 5% of our population is mentally ill. But in our jail system, what means 17 to 21% of our population is mentally ill.
And most people don't even know what this is. They don't have any idea.
Yeah. I mean, we're talking about people who are, you know, schizophrenic, schizoaffective, bipolar, who have overriding mental health issues. And we, by default, have made our jails into mental health facilities. The number one mental health facility in the country is L.A. County Jail. The number two mental health facility is Cook County. Number three is Rikers Island. You have to literally go down 13 or 14 before you get to a publicly funded, publicly accessible mental health facility. Now, my question is, look, I want to be fiscally conservative about the money that we have. We need to make sure that we get the biggest bang for the buck that we have. And what we've been able to demonstrate is that we can lock somebody up for $35,000 to $40,000 a year, or we can spend $3,000 to $5,000 a year stabilizing that person, holding them criminally accountable, having them come down and see a judge and a prosecutor and defense attorney once a week. Anywhere from 12 months to 36 months. They have a better quality of life. We are fiscally sounder as a community. Our taxpayer dollars are spent and go a longer way because these folks stay in jail longer. They come back at a higher frequency. They cost us as taxpayers more money. They cost our resources for law enforcement a lot of money. And so we have found a win-win situation. We're talking about people who are mentally ill but legally competent, who are held accountable for their behavior, and they're given the help that they deserve, and we save money. Now, these kind of programs have been identified, which I'm very excited to tell you, Steve, is that we just got nominated in the last 2 weeks, Salt Lake City, in our different programs, as one of the top three cities in the world for the World Leadership Awards. We're going to be, in fact, on December 5th, I'm going to be going to London, England to compete against Stuttgart, Germany, and Madrid, Spain, under the Law and Order Division category, excuse me, to compete. Yeah,
that's wonderful. That's great.
Very excited. It's a creative marriage of creative problem solving, public policy, fiscal soundness, and good results for our community. And so it was really exciting that we're gonna vie for the number one spot in the world.
It's exciting to hear that Salt Lake's being recognized, not just internationally, but internationally also for things that are going on here around the valley.
Well, it's good public policy, and it's about solving problems in our community. I think that's the next paradigm. Because look, district attorneys historically have responded to crime that happens out there, and it happens we're passive responders. What we need to be is proactive agents of change. That means that we not only hold criminals aggressively accountable, but we do it in a fiscally smart way. We will collaborate with other agencies, law enforcement, other agencies, and we come up with workable solutions which our community has a right to expect from us as a public institution.
As I've mentioned on the air before, I'm a delegate for the Republican Party, both the state and the county delegate, and I saw the Attorney General nominate Lohra Miller at convention, and she was running against
Ken Morgan.
Ken Morgan, who looked like a great guy, and the Attorney General gave a great speech, which I think got her nominated. And I guess if we were being totally fair to her, we'd have her on this program sometime before the elections, which we probably won't. Her speech, I didn't feel like, was extremely charismatic. And most of those votes were cast for the Attorney General as a show of support for him rather than a show of support for Lohra Miller. And so part of me has been afflicted. I've worried that she got the nomination mainly because she had the support of the Attorney General. And I'm not sure that she is as charismatic as she needs to be leading an organization of 200 people. She's accused you of some things. She says you micromanage the office at Salt Lake. I know from a girl I went to law school with that the people over there don't feel that way at all, that they feel very happy about the way they're being managed. And I'm sorry.
No, I was going to say, people say all sorts of negative things about you, and that's unfortunate because, this is a political process. But I think there's so much cynicism in our political process that let me just put it to you what my objective has been. My objective has been is that I don't care whether you're Republican or a Democrat. I don't care whether you're a liberal or a conservative or whatever, because this is really about a very serious office. It's about having a serious conversation, and it's about having an open and honest conversation. Look, I'm a parent of two young children, and God forbid something happens to them. Okay, I'm not going to ask you whether you're a Republican or a Democrat. I'm going to say, are you competent? Are you experienced? Do you have the proper skill set and knowledge and understanding and the leadership to bring justice home to me and my family? It's sort of like, when your house is burning down and firemen show up, you don't stop them and say, hey, what is your political affiliation before you have them put out the fire? And this is about our community. This is about our families. It is about our sense of safety. It is about all of us. And if there's one office that is not Republican or Democrat, this is it. And my appeal and an absolute sincere appeal to all your listeners, and you and I've talked about this, which is about, hey, if you believe in the ideas that I have, if you believe in the things that I'm saying, vote for me. If you don't, then don't. But it is ultimately bad things are going to happen to good people on November 8th after the election, and we have to have somebody there who can handle the job.
I wish we had more time in the program. That's the top of the hour. We appreciate you listening. Sim, really appreciate you being with us. Good luck Tuesday.
Thank you.
Stay tuned for Linda Strasberg. We'll be right back.